Hello all, this is my next video in the series of clinically oriented anatomy case-based questions and answers with their explanations, which will help in integrating the knowledge of anatomy with clinical aspects. This video has 5 clinical scenario-based MCQs related to abdomen region part 3. Coming to scenario 1. During an emergency surgery, it was found that a chronic gastric ulcer had perforated the posterior wall of the stomach and eroded a large artery running posterior to the stomach along the upper or superior border of the pancreas. This artery supplies parts of which of the following viscera? The options are A. Spleen and left kidney, B. Pancreas and duodenum, C. Liver, gallbladder and stomach, D. Stomach and pancreas. The correct answer is D. Stomach and pancreas. So looking to the stem of the question, the affected artery here is the splenic artery. The splenic artery is running just behind the lacer sac and stomach along the upper border of the pancreas. As we can see here in this figure, the splenic artery is one of the branch of celiac trunk, runs to the left, having a tortuous course behind the stomach and lacer sac and going to supply the spleen. The splenic artery has branches. It not only supplies the spleen, but it gives short gastric arteries which supply the fundus of the stomach. Then there is a left gastro-omental or left gastro-epiploic artery, which runs along the greater curvature of stomach along within the greater omentum, and it also gives numerous pancreatic branches which will supply the body and tail of pancreas. So the main organs supplied by the splenic artery are the spleen, the parts of pancreas and the parts of stomach. So the correct answer is stomach and pancreas. In option A, spleen is correct, but left kidney not supplied by splenic artery. B, pancreas part is supplied by splenic artery, but duodenum is not supplied by splenic artery. Whereas liver, gallbladder, they are not supplied by splenic artery. Those stomach, parts of stomach supplied by splenic artery. So the correct answer is both stomach and pancreas. Scenario 2, a 15-year-old boy complains of pain in the region of the umbilicus. He feels warm and uneasy and has no appetite. That night the pain seemed to have moved to the right lower abdominal region and he is then taken to the emergency by his parents. Which nerves perceived in the area of umbilicus most likely carried the painful sensations into the CNS? The options are A. Lacer splenic nerves, B. Greater splenic nerve, C. Pelvic splenic nerve, D. Least splenic nerve. Now this is the case of appendicitis, which is very common in the adolescent children. The pain of appendicitis initially is felt around the region of umbilicus, and this is the example of referred pain. Later the pain shifts to the right iliac or inguinal region where the appendix is located because of the involvement of local parietal peritoneum. So the correct answer will be A. Lacer splenic nerve, which not only supplies sympathetic fibers to the appendix, but it also carries the painful sensation from the inflamed appendix. So let's see the sympathetic supply to the abdomen and pelvis. There are thoracoabdominal splenic nerves, greater, lesser and least. The greater splenic nerve formed by T5 to T9, lacer splenic is T10, T11 and the least splenic is T12. In addition, there are lumbar and sacral splenic nerves. They are all carrying preganglionic sympathetic fibers and they will synapse in the ganglia in the abdomen, namely celiac, superior inferior mesenteric, aorticorenal and hypogastric ganglia. And then the postganglionic fiber from these ganglia, they form various plexuses and eventually reach the organs running with the corresponding arteries to those organs in periarterial plexus. So these sympathetic fibers, these nerves which carry sympathetic fibers, also carry the painful sensation from the supplied organ. The appendix is supplied by sympathetic fiber mainly from T10. This splanchnic nerve has the root value T10 and T11. Now the pain sensation from appendix, so they will project to T10 segment of spinal cord. Now the T10 segment of spinal cord also supply the skin around the umbilicus. So on one side there is a visceral pain, the other side there is a somatic pain. Therefore, the pain of the appendicitis in the initial phases is around the umbilicus because of this common T10 root. Later, when the local parietal peritoneum is involved, here we can see the pain is felt in the right lower abdominal region, and there is a point known as McBurney's point, which is the site of maximum tenderness in appendicitis. So the correct answer in this case is LIS, is the lesser splanchnic nerve. The lesser splanchnic nerve carry painful sensation and project to T10 segment of spinal cord, which also supply the skin around the umbilicus. Scenario 3, a 52-year-old male is admitted to hospital with suspected peritoneal infection. Radiologists are trying to find the evidence of some free fluid, that is pus or blood, in the peritoneal cavity of this patient during ultrasound examination. Which is the most likely place they would find any free fluid in the abdomen in supine position? The options are A. Pouch of Douglas, B. Laser sac, C. Hepatorenal pouch, D. Paracolic gutters. The correct answer is C. Hepatorenal pouch. Hepatorenal pouch, also known as the Morrison's pouch, as we can see here, it is the right posterior space or right subhepatic space, and this space or recess is bounded anteriorly by the inferior surface of the right lobe of liver and gallbladder, whereas posteriorly there will be the right suprarenal gland and upper part of the right kidney along with the second part of duodenum, hepatic flexure of colon, transverse mesocolon and part of head of pancreas. Superiorly, we can see here, there is an inferior layer of coronary ligament, whereas inferiorly it opens into general peritoneal cavity. This hepatorenal space or hepatorenal pouch is very important clinically. It is the most dependent part, that is the lowest part of the abdominal cavity proper, when the body is in supine position. Fluids tend to get collected here, as we can see. This is the commonest site of subphrenic abscess, which may be caused by spread of infection from gallbladder, appendix or other organs in the region. Whereas in the pelvic cavity, as we can see here, the most dependent part will be the rectovesical pouch in the male or rectouterine, that is pouch of Douglas, in the female, and this is in supine position. Whereas in the upright position, if the patient is nursed in such inclined position, then the most dependent part in the pelvic cavity will be the pouch of Douglas in female and the rectovesical pouch in the male. So option A, pouch of Douglas, is not correct anyway because the patient is a male and not the female. Pouch of Douglas will be in the female. Laser sac is the left posterior space, which is also not most dependent part. And then there are paracolic gutters, right and left. There is right paracolic gutter, which opens freely into hepatorenal pouch at its upper end. And there is left paracolic gutter, which opens freely into the pelvis at the lower end. So out of the four options, the correct answer is hepatorenal pouch, which is most dependent part of the abdominal cavity proper in the supine position. Coming to scenario 4, a 50-year-old patient has hiatal hernia in which the cardia of the stomach protrudes through the esophageal hiatus of diaphragm into the thorax. Which of the following structures is or are at the greatest risk of injury during surgical repair of this hernia? The options are A. Right phrenic nerve, B. Thoracic duct and azygous vein, सी सिंपथेटिक चेन्स डी वेगस नर्व्स. द करेक्ट आंसर इज डी वेगस नर्व्स. सो एज देर इज अ हायटस हर्निया एज वी कैन सी द पार्ट ऑफ स्टमक दैट इज कार्डिया प्रोड्रूट्स टू इसोफेजियल हायटस ऑफ डायफ्राम. So we must know the major openings in the diaphragm. As in this figure, we are viewing from the inferior, from abdominal side. We can see the three major openings. One is the vena cava opening, through which passes the inferior vena cava and right phrenic nerve. Then there is the esophageal opening, through which passes esophagus as well as the left and right vagus nerves and the esophageal branch of left gastric artery. And then there is the aortic hiatus or aortic opening, through which pass aorta, thoracic duct and azygous vein. So as we can see here, there are three major openings: vena cava opening, esophageal opening and the aortic opening. And here these are the vagus nerves which passes through the same esophageal opening as the esophagus, which then opens into the stomach. So the affected part here is the cardia of the stomach, which is protruding through esophageal hiatus. And the only structure out of four which passes through the same hiatus is the vagus nerves. Right phrenic nerve, as we just saw, passes through vena cava opening. Thoracic duct and azygous vein passes through aortic opening. Whereas sympathetic chains, they will pass down deep to medial arcuate ligament. Whereas subcostal vessels and nerve will pass deep to lateral arcuate ligament, as we can see here. So these are very important structures passing through various openings of diaphragm. In this case, the correct answer is the vagus nerves. Scenario 5, an obstetrician performs a median episiotomy on a woman before parturition to prevent uncontrolled excessive tearing of the pelvic diaphragm. If the perineal body is damaged, the function of which of the following muscle pairs might be impaired? The options are A. Levator ani and ischiocavernosus, B. Bulbous spongiosus and superficial transverse perineal, C. Deep transverse perineal and obturator internus, D. External anal sphincter and sphincter urethri. The correct answer is B. Bulbous spongiosus and superficial transverse perineal. So we must know the various muscles which interlace here in the perineal body. The perineal body is the central point of the perineum, located about 1.25 cm in front of anal margin. It is very important for support of pelvic viscera. There are different muscles which interlace here and attach to the perineal body, out of which two are unpaired. The unpaired are this: one is the external anal sphincter. This is the external anal sphincter, and other is the fibers of the conjoint longitudinal muscle of the anal canal. And others are paired muscle, that is bulbous spongiosus. Then there are superficial and deep transverse perinei muscle. And then there is a levator ani muscle. In case of female, here we can see this is the deep transverse perineal muscle. Then there is a superficial transverse perineal muscle, bulbous spongiosus. Then there will be levator ani. This muscle is the external anal sphincter. And in addition, there will be fibers of longitudinal muscle coat of anal canal. All these muscles are attached to perineal body. So if the perineal body is damaged, these muscles will be affected. The other options, that is ischiocavernosus, is not attached to perineal body, so this is not the correct answer. Then the obturator internus is also not attached to perineal body, and sphincter urethri muscle is also not attached to perineal body. So the only correct answer, the only correct pair is bulbous spongiosus and superficial transverse perineal body. So if perineal body is damaged, the function of these pair of muscle will be affected. So thank you. Keep sharing, like and subscribe my channel if you benefit from the video. And look forward to more case-based scenarios involving clinical anatomy of each and every region of the body. Thank you.